Welcome to Target's Iced Out of the Workplace webinar. This is the pre-recorded version because I blew the live version back on July 7th, 2012. And so for that, I apologize. This is Gary Namie, representing both Ruth and Gary Namie. Ruth is the instrumental reason for the movement itself and the co-founder of Workplace Bullying Institute. But I'm doing all the talking today, so sorry, you're going to be stuck with me. So today's topic really is close to my heart because I'm a social psychologist, and I'm thunderstruck by the power of the group that goes untapped in the workplace to stop the evilness of workplace bullying. By that I mean there are so many opportunities for teams of workers to gang up, if you will, on the perpetrators and shame them and humiliate them into submission and to get them to stop, but it usually doesn't happen that way. In fact, the other way around is actually more the case. The single lone perpetrator usually is able to cow into silence all of the coworkers. And for a variety of reasons, the target becomes the pariah, and it's the target who gets iced out of the workplace and is rendered a loner, dysfunctional, broken, humiliated, and quite ashamed. And so this icing out phenomenon, which is very preventable, but is a natural part of sick, toxic group dynamics, is the topic today. So that's what I want to talk about. So let's go ahead and get started. In this graphic picture, this graphic art is what we had used in our book cover for The Bully at Work. And the little red-orange guy or gal is clearly isolated and surrounded. You know, it's interesting because, and now we're just going to show you some of the things that are often said to the targeted person. So the little red guy gal is a target. And, you know, the person who is targeted often will seek mental health counseling help, and they'll talk to a therapist, and they tell them what's going on, and they sound crazy. Their presenting complaint makes them sound crazy because they are often characterized as paranoid. But in reality, they're not paranoid. That is their reality. They're getting slammed on an almost daily basis with attacks and assaults, verbal assaults. And some of those verbal assaults are... some of those verbal assaults are very personal. And those are the most harmful. They're called ad hominem attacks. See, there's a difference between calling a person lazy, or even, as it says here, nobody wants you here anyway, versus you're so stupid that your mother couldn't even like you. And so it's those cutting, dehumanizing, deep insults and epithets that get a person, the name-calling. A monkey could do your job, for instance. That sort of a thing. So, as you see, it's a real problem. Now, I like this one. If you don't like it, like me, there's the door. Don't let it hit you on the ass on the way out. So the person sounds paranoid because this is exactly their world. If you've never been in that world where you hear all this crosstalk at once and it's overwhelming, this is what makes a person need and seek mental health days and pay time off. They need to get out of there. Icing out is a great term. We love it. Even use it in some expert witness testimony. But the truth is, the science, social scientists like to call it ostracism or social exclusion. And I'm adding to that abandonment, because abandonment is when the person is thrown out of the group and expelled, and they're no longer befriended. They no longer can be seen with their coworkers. If you run into them in the store in town, they will go down the opposite aisle just to avoid you. Total abandonment. Now, this is, I'm talking about coworkers, essentially, as distinguished from family and friends. Now, family and friends can also abandon the targeted person, but it happens a lot later. Family and friends are the only ones who do hang around and support the target. So it's ostracism and social exclusion and abandonment by the folks at work, your fellow workers and your bosses, that we're concerned about here. It's very, very important that we understand that as social animals, it is a deep inherent need for affiliation that drives much of our behavior. we seek to be around others. Just as our cats and dogs love us and love their humans and they have their people, we humans love humans and we crave the attention that only humans can give. And that is the social support that we'll refer to so often during this brief talk. And it's really sick and toxic if a person is able to deny that that connection. It's rather sadistic, if you will, to deny that compassion. But I just a quick aside about that compassion and the capacity for compassion. It's I often refer to the neuroscience, the new research using functional MRI that's been so effective at clarifying so many of our behaviors and so many mysteries. Well, one of them is, why is it some people are capable of empathy and others aren't? And it seems that there are individual differences. And if a child grows up deprived of parental love, grows up with parental neglect, and is treated coldly, remember the old Harlow studies that you may have read about in Psychology 101, the wire monkey and the cloth monkey. Well, the cloth monkey provided nurturance in addition to a nipple providing food and sustenance, but the wire monkey only provided the food, and the deprived one monkeys were the ones who were raised, quote, raised by the wire monkey. So there are cold human beings, as cold as that wire monkey, to their children, and it appears that there are differences in two brain areas. One is the insula, which is a midbrain area that has a great deal to do with predicting our effectiveness in social relationships. And then the cortical gray matter area in the prefrontal cortex. Now that's right behind your forehead bone there. The prefrontal cortex is the seat of so many different functions that are important for our behavior and for our success. One of them, however, is empathy. And literally those people who are deprived in early life of warmth from a parent grow up without the capacity for empathy, and they have a smaller volume in that particular area of the brain. The rule from neuroscience is cortical volume. The volume in your cortex is going to determine the extent of your behavioral repertoire. So if you're lacking in the cortex in a key area, you're going to be lacking in an ability to execute that behavior. So low empathy is the result of reduced mass in that part of the prefrontal cortex. Anyway, it's important. I guess my point to justify that aside is that when people say others are cutting you out and it's no big deal, grow up, get an alternative, my gosh, you're an adult, don't let this hurt you, it hurts and it's very, very painful because it denies your humanity, without a doubt. And the key ingredient here is that the denial of that bond, of that empathic bond, is stressful for the recipients. That's you, the targeted person. So here's a quick lesson in stress. Stress begins with stressors. Stressors are factors outside the individual that will generate stress, that trigger the human stress response. Now, let's start on the right side. There are aspects of the physical environment clearly that have been known to be stressful, and they would include exposure to toxic chemicals, bad air, repeated stress injuries because the nature of the work is going to require repeated motions, very limited motions that lead to carpal tunnel, bad seating, which leads to back injuries and bad posture, too much of a sedentary lifestyle, which leads to other physical injuries and impairments and arthritis and all the rest. So you see, stressors in the physical environment can lead to physical injury. Now, we live more on the left side of this slide and this graph, where we're talking about the psychosocial environment that contains rules and people. And if we split that into work conditions on the right side, and typically over-demanding work conditions, in fact, let's start there. This is an area on the right that researchers for at least a half a century now, primarily out of Britain in what's called a series of Whitehall studies, they've been following British civil servants for a long, long, long time. And they noticed that as two factors can account for a great deal of stress in humans, and that is increasing task demand, asking people to do more while simultaneously giving less control over what that work actually is. And that's called job strain. Now, job strain has been linked causally, which means it causes, job strain causes cardiovascular disease, coronary heart disease, heart in the arteries, strokes, heart attacks, and death, cardiac arrest. So it clearly leads to the human stress response. That's the right side. But the most significant part, a negative part of a psychosocial environment, is when a person is subjected to personalized assaults from another human being, where it's a full front-on, full-bore, unequivocal, personalized assault and attack. And that's what bullying can be. And then that, of course, generates the most distress. In fact, there are studies that look at the full range of psychosocial factors, and when bullying is present, it is more distressful than any other form, any other factor. And distress, not eustress, eustress, e-eustress, is happy stress. I'm jumping out of a plane via parachute, but you know I want to do this, so it's really, really, really fun. But distress, which is the uninvited, unwanted misery from toxic work environment, bad psychosocial environment, is going to lead to stress-related diseases, and stress-related diseases kill. We'll credit that statement about stress-related diseases killing people to Robert Sapolsky and his book, Why Zebras Don't Get Ulcers. Highly recommended book. We need you to get this. It is the Bible of stress. He writes in medical journals, but he's a funny, plain-spoken person, too, who can describe all of these factors to the layman. You gotta get this book. Now, what I want to play for you is a very brief clip in which Sapolsky, and there's how you spell his name, describes to us the role and importance of social support.
You take a monkey and you put it in a big new empty cage. Monkeys don't like novelty. Their blood pressure goes up. Okay. Take a monkey, put it in a big empty cage, and fill it up with a bunch of other monkeys that it's never seen before. Blood pressure goes even higher. Take the monkey, put it in a cage with a bunch of monkeys it already knows and doesn't like. Blood pressure goes even higher. Take the monkey, put it in a brand new cage with a bunch of its friends, and its blood pressure doesn't go up. It helps to have friends. The single most powerful fact in all of behavioral medicine, when you look at all the infectious diseases across the board, the single biggest predictor of mortality when you look at lifestyle risk factors is if you were socially isolated. When you look at people at the extreme of social isolation versus social affiliation, threefold difference in the survival rates. And that's a bigger variable than if you smoke or not, if you are overweight or not, if you have elevated cholesterol levels or not. Social isolation for a social species is one of the most aching stressors you can ever have.
There. He backed up exactly what I said. As an aching, one of the most aching stressors you can have. All right. So where does this come from? This withdrawal of social support, this social exclusion. Clearly it can come from a boss or a manager. And what they can do is exclude you from major tasks so that you will appear to be a minor contributor, if at all a contributor to performance and the company's success. So they can ice you out there. And then also the boss can actually command people in the group, your coworkers, to isolate you. So that's, of course, the most unnerving part of it all is when we cow in shame and actually give in to the boss who actually tells us to do that. So it's pretty stinking pathetic, without a doubt. So it comes from bosses and coworkers, basically everywhere in the workplace. Let's talk about the paths to exclusion and rejection. Social exclusion can be done intentionally, without a doubt. As I said right before, by command, where the boss tells someone or the lead coworker in the leader of the pack, the head of the queen bees, the puppet master behind all the other coworkers, and basically tells all the rest of them to isolate you and to never pay attention to you at all. You know, when coworkers isolate someone, they have tremendous power, not in terms necessarily of work product, but much more in terms of just defining somebody's humanity. You know, if you never talk about what the latest movies are or how your kids of the same age are acting and misbehaving and getting thrown out of school and all that and what you did to deal with it, it can be very, very, very painful. Anyway, there's intentional exclusion by command. Then there's by coercion and incentives, especially by bosses. It's where people dangle, now you know what, you know, there was a university supervisor who did it, she did coerce subordinates, that's true. She actually offered them a $5 every Friday if they were extremely loyal to her that week, and she gave them a sandwich. Honest to God, I couldn't believe that. But most often, it's much more subtle than that. In other words, you be with me, you side with me, and that can be done explicitly. So this is an intentional version here. So I'm telling you, side with me, and all good things, you can have anything you want. You will enjoy favoritism from me, and that includes and results in ball game tickets and extra time off, and I let you cheat on your time clock and all that other kind of stuff. So by coercion and incentives, without a doubt. Then there's intentional social exclusion by the factors of the forces of what we will call social influence. A little bit more about that down the road, but briefly stated right here, social influence is when other people actually define our realities for us. Now, you might think that's a ridiculous statement, but the truth is, it's often done. We rely upon others in many, many circumstances, typically ambiguous ones. Like I said, we'll come back. That's a big point. And sometimes it can be done by voluntary choice. Somebody decides to be sadistic. I hope that's a minority, but you know what? From the stories that we've heard and the places we've been and the harm that we've seen inflicted on other people, I think this is getting to be more and more prevalent. People actually think they have the right to crush other people. They think that's something that they can do at work. And of course, if the organization doesn't follow up with accountability and punishment, then they're going to take from that indifference what they call tacit approval. They're going to believe that they're getting rewarded, and they'll just continue to do it over and over again. We're a cruel nation, and this, why wouldn't we be cruel at work is the point. So go ahead and intentionally reject somebody else. It's the thing to do. And I might say that we're learning a lot of this from our reality shows. I thought in the beginning reality shows reflected our American nature and our preference for humiliating other people and demeaning and putting them down. But then at the end of every round of every reality show episode, there is an exclusion. There's a rejection. There's a banishment. Somebody's got to be thrown off the island or out of the house or they don't have a chance to get married to this man or woman again, that kind of a thing. But I think that is not a reflection as much as it is a training tool. I think it's training people to be harder and harsher and coarser. And so there's a lot more of this voluntary choice. It could be unintentional too. Social rejection of another person could be done unintentionally. How? It's a sad fact. Because of our narcissistic focus on ourselves. Our lens is focused very much on ourselves here. It's me, 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 me. And therefore, I don't have time for you. So I exclude you inadvertently because there's only so much time in a day. And if it's all about my career and my accomplishments and my self-promotion and my impression management, then I'm never going to get around to little old you, without a doubt. It also could be totally unintentional if we just mimic what other people are doing. We're not actually making the choice to reject somebody else, but we copy what it is they do, which is rejecting behavior. So we're no better off than the ones who made the voluntary choice because we're copying those fools. So it can happen intentionally, unintentionally is the point. Social influence is a very, very, very important topic. And so let me start the story of the history of the study of social influence. Actually, in the 1940s, it started with the original conformity studies by social psychologist Solomon Ash. And I'm not going to review those for you here, but just let it be known that most people, when they were fed a pile of crackers, would eat crackers endlessly, especially when they weren't given water. Even though they weren't given water, they would eat it endlessly if they were sitting in the university and somebody in a lab coat was shoving soda crackers across a table at them. Then later, Ash had people looking at drawings of lines, and they would objectively make mistakes, without a doubt. And they would conform. So there's tremendous conformity. Conformity is a form of social influence. And here in the 1960s, with this woman, Kitty Genovese, and her murder on March 16th, 1964, comes the tale that really revolutionizes a large part of social science, where we abandon some old antiquated ideas about why people acted in support of other people and why they helped. So, briefly put, here's this woman, Kitty Genovese. She's a waitress who comes home to her Queens, New York apartment right here in this block. Now, I don't know if you can see that there is number one. There's a little white arrow toward the top of the picture, the middle picture, actually. There's a parking garage down at the end. And she had come home in the middle of the night, or 2 p.m., 2 a.m. or so, very late, in this darkened street, and left her car and began to walk down the sidewalk toward the entrance of her building, which is down here toward the white sign. And she is assaulted. This is 1964. She's not gunned down by drive-by shooting, but rather she's stabbed by an assailant. And she lets out horrific screams. Now, right across the street is an apartment building in which we knew there were at least 38 witnesses to the murder. A rather taller building, and one in which when they heard her alarming cry, they rose to the window and turned on the lights, put up the blinds, and could look outside to see what was happening. When those lights came on, two things happened. The assailant fled because he thought he was detected. And the second thing that happened was that nothing happened. Not one of the 38 witnesses actually called the police in time to save Kitty Genovese's life. Because when the lights came on, they just as quickly went off. And when the building was darkened again, as Kitty dragged her bloody body toward the doorstep to get into her apartment building there at the bottom of the picture, the assailant returned and finished her off. This time when she screamed, her last muttered screams, what happened was one person did call the police. The police came, but it was too late. She was already dead. They were able to apprehend the assailant. But the headlines in the New York Times railed about apathetic New Yorkers. Abe Rosenthal, one of the writers, principal writers of the New York Times then and future editor, wrote a book called 38 Witnesses. And he says, what have we become? What have we turned into? So now when we try and look at the explanations of why these witnesses, why these bystanders didn't intervene, one of the first explanations is that these were callous, heartless New Yorkers. And I tell you the truth, I think until 9/11, New Yorkers had that horrific stereotype about them. And of course, that all was kind of washed away in the goodwill of how New Yorkers helped one another. But that's one explanation, and that's also a personality-driven explanation, and that's a very, very common thing here in the U.S. to use. A second potential explanation is whenever somebody is witnessing a dangerous situation or an emergency happening to someone else, and they're live watching it there, they are probably afraid to intervene because of danger to themselves. I mean, after all, if the person's wielding a knife or a gun, you're not going to just feel like hurling yourself between the criminal and the victim and saying you can't do that to her. Most certainly without a gun, and most certainly not with knives. Although it's interesting, when a person does still try and knife someone, harm someone with a knife, you'll notice that many, many people will jump on that person because they're much less afraid of a knife, and they can usually force the knife away from the person and overwhelm them. The gun doesn't allow that to happen. But there is that big fear. The non-intervention can be predicted by fear of witnesses of personal danger, without a doubt. But there were two social psychologists that looked at the Kitty Genovese murder and said, you know what? It's not about people. It's not about New Yorkers. It's not about individuals. Let's get off the personality. It's about the situation. And now here's what's going to start to apply to you in the workplace when you're wondering why it is people turn their back, your coworkers turn their back on you when you really desperately need help and you can't understand why they don't come to your rescue. Yes, bullet number two, they are afraid themselves. They're cowards. We know that. There is that part of us, that sheepish part of all of us. But this third bullet, this diffusion of responsibility, is what Bib Latané and John Darley called, or used to describe the Kitty Genovese murder. How could not one of 38 do anything? Because each person was aware, through the reflection of the lighted window, their lighted window, that other people were aware of what was happening to Kitty. And so therefore, they assumed someone else would be calling. And because everyone assumed someone else would call and no one called, she died. And so no one stepped up and took personal responsibility, but instead the responsibility was diffused or spread out or distributed and minimized across all 38, making it highly unlikely that anyone would do anything. Now, all the subsequent decades of research on it's called the bystander effect. All those decades of research show that as the size of the group grows, the likelihood of intervention decreases, without a doubt. So if you're going to need help, you want to get help from the few and the mighty, as opposed to having 10, 15 witnesses. It's less likely anyone will do anything. Now, again, the characteristic of that situation in the Genovese murder is people were aware of the presence of others, but they weren't aware of the action of others. So that first instance of social influence is other people can convey a message to do nothing if you're not aware of what the other people are doing. It's easier to do nothing when you're not aware of what other people are doing. So that lack of awareness can really work against a victim, or in this case in the workplace, a target. And now lastly, and that's an enormous fact, finding. For all of my teaching in social psychology and my work in altruism, that was my favorite topic, diffusion of responsibility. I think it has held up the test of time, without a doubt. And there are ways to maximize personal responsibility, and we'll talk about that, the solutions, here in a second. The neuroanatomy of compassion. Back to neuroscience. Brand new, relatively new study out a couple years out of the USC neuroscience lab. Explored why people might not express compassion, in fact, adulation for another person, positive feelings toward another person are a heck of a lot easier to feel than compassion for someone who is relatively desperate and saddening. And again, that's part of empathy. If I'm going to feel compassion for the person, I'm going to feel empathy. And if their story is sad, I will also feel sad, so I don't want to feel sad. Well, the point was from that functional MRI study is adulation is relatively activates relatively few areas of the brain, and it's relatively immediate. It's pretty swift, but compassion has many areas of the brain affected, and it's a latent response. It takes a lot of time for the brain to process a need in another human being, and then to go on and feel and experience the emotion of compassion. So compassion is really effortful. And so maybe in our little truncated, crazy little 140-character Twitterized world, we're not capable of compassion because we don't hang around long enough to see somebody else's plight. And let's translate this. Let's make this very tangible for a target situation. You, the target, come out slump-shouldered from a closed-door meeting where you've just been reamed. It's very easy for the co-workers to avert their gaze. If they avert their gaze and they can shut off that opportunity for empathy, for reading your emotional state then they don't have to trigger compassion, they don't give their brain time, and therefore they save themselves the emotional energy of feeling compassion for you. It's all sad. So you have, with diffusion of responsibility, a structural situational explanation. And with the neuroanatomy, you have a neuroscience brain function explanation. And these weren't available to us in the early days when all we said was, well, if nobody helped, they were lousy people. Not necessarily so. Now, how does social exclusion play that? These are just some of the ways, and I know if we had a good interaction here, we could, you would give me a list of probably 50 or 60 of these things. But these are some major categories I thought of beforehand. Your contributions, the target's contributions in meetings are discounted or omitted. And if everyone's comments or suggestions or brainstorming ideas are written down, the targets are not. So they're omitted. They're actually excluded. They could be blocked from participation in team tasks, which is a really, really, really important way to make sure the person gets no visibility, no credit. They don't look like they even work there. Now, that's not by their choice, but by virtue of not showing up, executives and the other people, the head honchos, don't really bother to ask why you're missing. You were told to be missing. You were prevented from participating. And you're seen as missing in action, MIA. There are tons and tons of ways that people send you messages of social exclusion non-verbally. They do it primarily through body language. They do it through tone and intonation. All of those aspects of, we spent a lot of time on this in Workplace Bullying University, paralinguistic cues and all that. We talk a lot about non-verbal language. And they're all important, and they send the message to the person, you are not one of us. Then there can even be interesting nonverbal ways in terms of costuming and ways of dress that set you up to look like you're not even part of the team. If there are agreed upon colors on a particular day, honest to God, it's true. Like an orange Friday, this one firm actually fired employees who dressed in orange for happy hour Friday. But I was thinking, what if you didn't get the memo to wear orange for happy hour Friday? You're not part of the group that's going to the bar after work on Friday for happy hour Friday. I just thought of the exclusion part of that. Of course, they were all excluded because the company fired him, which is really sick and twisted. But anyway, lots of nonverbal messages. There are a million other ways that a person can be devalued. The put downs, the verbal abuse, the belittlement, the fact that you are called stupid and attacked in that way. The fact that you're told whatever your opinions are not good enough. That you're untrainable and you're too stupid and all the rest. That sort of a thing. That's all part of ways to be unvalidated in a way. And then finally, there's the office space method of isolating people physically. Actually, moving you to another wing, moving your desk to an area where people cannot interact with you, blocking you off, putting your back to a work area where it's a really collaborative, creative process. It's necessary. People need to see each other and be able to look at each other face to face. And here you're mandated to be back to face, that kind of a thing. So that physical isolation, I forget the name of that little guy whose desk they kept moving in office space. But you know what I mean. And probably the most hurtful thing of all is, and it's something that actually validates your humanity, is your relationships with people from work, outside of work. It's important, social relationships. And those are cut off. Usually when you are ostracized at work, you are ostracized socially after work. And so it becomes extremely difficult to have good relationships out there. So you were a part of the bowling team, and now you're not part of the bowling team. You were a part of the happy hour crowd. You're not happy hour crowd. You used to go to the movies with everybody else's families, and that's not it. Your kids play together in the park, and now they've chosen another park, or they tell you to play at a different time. It's pretty amazing. Let me give you an example of something that just came to mind from one of the legal cases I worked with years and years ago. Clinical psychologist Gloria, a school counselor, a college counselor, college student counselor, very effective, loved her job, veteran, 20 plus years. And into her life comes this Napoleonic twit of a boss who suddenly had control over her future. And he hated her. And she filed a sexual harassment complaint against him. And his retaliatory gesture was to make her move from one of the Manhattan boroughs on campus, where she had done her work all those years, down to the Manhattan Central office. And it was there that he set up a plank between two file cabinets and a typewriter was placed on it, and an otherwise empty room. And she was forced to work in there 8 hours a day without being able to converse with anybody else in the central office. So she couldn't make new friendships. She was totally isolated inside the place where most of the people worked at the central office. And she was told she had to plan her bathroom trips. She had to ask permission from a clerk that was outside her room. And she was not allowed to lunch with, literally, he forbade her from lunching with any of the staff in that office. And they all went along with it. And it damn near made her crazy. That resulted in a $1.4 million settlement against the college. But not before it had broken her and really, really, really hurt her and made her a cynical, bitter person at that point. Took a long, long time to get over that. I just thought of that manifestation. What a sick, twisted guy. I'm going to tell you about a study that we did. But every time I mention a study at WBI, Workplace Bullying Institute, I assume people know how to get there. So let's assume you don't. Here's the front page. After you've clicked targets, target seeking help. This is the meat of our website in here. And this menu bar here, we're pointing right at workplace bullying research. There's a drop-down menu. Mouse over that, go to that drop-down menu, WB Research. Then, within WB Research, select WBI Publications. Workplace Bullying Research at WBI. And we've got three sort of collections in there. We've got Namie and Namie Research and Publications. And that's the WBI work. We've also got this collection of papers by David Yamada, who is an affiliate of WBI, who was on the board, and a dear, dear friend. We're all joined at the hip there. And his what he's doing for the legal reform and for the law and law schools is trying to get them to understand workplace bullying while we do the lay world out here. And then the third part, by the way, under this selection is International Research Library, where we have over 200 articles there that you may go try and find. If you do attend Workplace Bullying University ever, we give you those articles. Those are the foundation for our research-driven approach to workplace bullying. So it goes well beyond the studies that we do. We do studies online at WBI, which means they are studies of targets, targeted individuals. We're the definitive resource in the world for the view of the workplace through the lens of a targeted individual, without a doubt. And we've done two national studies, which are scientific and representative. But those primarily we do these self-selected large sample surveys online. So if you select the WBI thing there, select Namie and Namie Research and Publications, and that'll lead to this page. And what you need to do then is scroll down, and I have it in reverse chronology. So we have instant poll, the aftermath of contacting HR for help, in 2012, poll C, study C. And I'm about to post 2012 D here within the month, which is already complete. But if you scroll all the way down, you will find the next study. In Labor Day 2008, So if you scroll down to Labor Day 2008, you can download a copy of this, of the questions and the following graph. And it's basically we asked 400 individuals who came to our website, what is it that coworkers actually do and don't do? And it ranges from confronting the bully to betraying the target. And I'm wondering if you would like to hazard a guess. Let me pause for a second here and let you guess. What percentage of targets reported that their coworkers bravely and boldly confronted, as a group, the bully and got him to stop? If you guessed 1%, you overestimated. It is less than 1%, 0.8%, 0.8%. Oh, coworkers are more than willing to give lots and lots of advice. About 36% of them did that. Interestingly, about 16% literally were neutral and said they did nothing. The targets said their coworkers did nothing. Now, that's important because doing nothing is not a neutral act. Doing nothing is actually a negative act because they have turned their back. It is a form of social exclusion. They've turned their back on a person who has asked for help. They're separated and betrayed here, ending our graph. But let's go dig deeper into the details here by looking at the next slide. So here's the breakdown of where those bars in that bar graph came from. And I want to direct your attention to the bottom section there where, with all of the red ink. That, let me read it to you. That coworkers voluntarily isolated the target in 13.2% of the cases. They were ordered to isolate. So you see, voluntarily isolated, not sure. From the target's point of view, it looked like the coworkers turned on him. But when they what percent actually were known to have been ordered to isolate them? 5%, 4.8. Coworkers betrayed, the betrayal is incredible. The betrayal is huge. Coworkers betrayed the target while still faking a friendship, 13%. Coworkers turned on the target, were aggressive, openly aggressive, and were clearly the bully's ally at 15%. And so you can see that negative adds up to a whole lot of activity. So this is why coworkers break your heart. Coworkers are afraid and they don't want to get involved. And it could be that diffusion of responsibility phenomenon operating too. But for a whole host of reasons, coworkers have turned their back on you and they're shunning you. And they're shunning you and treating you like a pariah. And you're a good person. We always say, as we look at the profile of targets, they're the salt of the earth. They are typically independent, technically skilled, well-liked, emotionally intelligent. They are the empathic ones. They're the good guys and gals. A study in 2010 by Parks and Stone is called titled The Desire to Expel Unselfish Members from the Group. If you're one of the good guys and you're willing to help other people, you're what we call altruist. You're an altruist. You have a pro-social orientation. You're a pro-social versus an anti-social person. Bullies are anti-social, targets are pro-social. They're cooperative and bullies are competitive. So it's two different worldviews, two different sides of a coin, completely different. In this study, there was actually a simulated group. So it wasn't done with a real work group. It was done with workers, adults, not college kids. But they played a game where people were described as how did they contribute to the group. And some people knocked themselves out. They had a chance to give money to the group and then at the end take money from the group. The people who were defined as altruists were the people who gave a lot of money to the group. They're very pro-social, and they took the least amount of money at the end. The selfish people gave the least, took the most. Then they would play the game for several rounds, and the pot would change, and then the group members were asked who should be expelled. Sort of they played Survivor, one of the TV reality show games. And lo and behold, the first groups thrown out were the selfish individuals. They had, after all, given the least and taken the most. The second group chosen were the altruists, the good people, the ones who had over-contributed and under-withdrawn. They had taken less than they had actually put into the group, and they got stuck by the group and thrown out, expelled, rejected, excluded, ostracized, iced out, shunned. Two explanations, theoretical explanations, were given by the authors. And they're really versions, two versions of the same sort of concept. Number one is, altruists actually are not beloved because they set a standard that the group, other group members cannot attain. It's like you make it too hard for us to keep up with you, and we're always going to be falling short, and so we don't feel good when you're in our group. So you're out. And the second theoretical explanation, they got at both of these by lots of questioning and surveys and interviews with the people afterwards. The second one, and this one I think really pertains to targets, is that the coworkers, the group members, not the coworkers, but substitute coworkers, believed that the target, the altruist, was more moral than they were personally. So it was a personal high, and that you had to be banished because it made the other person, by social comparison, feel guilty. So it made the group feel they couldn't, that they were worthless, and it made the individual feel that they were less worthy. So that's why the altruists, even though they enhance the power of the group, the strength of the group, and altruists are needed in every group, somebody's got to be the one being the glue, holding the group together and doing things for the group, they get thrown out. Apply that little study to your workplace targeting situation. And I think some of you will find that it is applicable, and isn't it pathetic? The definitive study that really is worth reading, and if you write to me, I will send you a copy if you cannot find this copy, because it would be that single-use copy for research purposes. It's Kip Williams out of Purdue, his 2007 study, simply titled Ostracism. It's not a compilation, it's not a summary of one study, but a compilation of several studies. And so annual review articles are always better that way. And the technique that Williams uses to get at ostracism is ball tossing. And he does it in person when people are in a room together and a ball toss begins spontaneously when somebody pulls out a Nerf ball and starts tossing it to someone else, presumably a stranger. Of course, it's not a stranger, but that's okay. It's all set up. That person's a Confederate. But those two toss the ball, and then the real subject participant in the study is sitting there wondering what the hell's going on, and suddenly a ball is tossed to them, so they're brought into this three-way ball toss. So they're included, and then a video camera focuses on the individual as the ball toss excludes them. So they were at first included, then excluded. So there was social exclusion. And this can be repeated via playback on a computer screen, and it's called Cyberball. So if you go to Kip Williams' website and look up Cyberball, you can actually download, I think, the game Cyberball. Anyway, there's a lot more you can learn about it. In fact, you probably ought to go there. I think you can probably get the article free from him. But if not, drop us a note, and we will see that you get it. Now, what came out of this series of studies, both the in-person studies, and then he uses Cyberball in the functional MRI environment. By that I mean, when a person is inside an MRI machine, they are, for social science research, they have a special headgear attached that contains a computer screen to display information. They can read a story, and their hands are on buttons that allow them to make choices between options A, B, C, D, that sort of a thing, multiple choice. So we can see what the brain is doing while they're thinking about the questions that are posed by the researchers. In this case, it's playing Cyberball, as the same thing as playing in a waiting room outside a research lab as part of the experiment. So what did Kip Williams find as the predictable pattern? Here it is. Number one, there's reflexive pain experienced by all people who are suddenly excluded after being included. And the functional MRI studies show that pain and trauma pathways in the brain are actually triggered. It's real pain. This is real pain that really requires ibuprofen, okay, to get rid of it. In fact, I'm fond of I forget where I was, and there was this in USA Today. They had reported this study about the about romantic breakups, and they asked people. They put them in the MRI machine there, the functional MRI, and they had them imagine the relationship they had just lost, and it triggered the same similar type pain pathways, and they said that the pain could be reduced by ibuprofen. So there. That bum left you, take two ibuprofen. So it's interesting. So social pain is physical pain. So there's that, number one. The second predictable response in the second stage is sadness and anger. So you go through pain, then sadness and anger. And in the videotapes of the people who have been excluded during the ball toss, in the waiting room studies, this is what is captured. Through the facial expressions. It's amazing. So there's loss, and then sadness, and then anger. Now, the third step depends on the individual. There's a filter, you see, a personality filter through which this whole icing out will play out in different ways depending upon who you are. It's all about denial of your needs to affiliate with other people, okay? So let's look on the left first. If you have a stronger need to belong, if you want to be in the group because it satisfies your sense of belongingness and community and ends your isolation and feels good because you're not alone, then what will happen when you're excluded is you're going to try really, really hard to get back in the group by doing things for the group. You're going to be pro-social. You're going to get on bended knee. You're going to do things, begging to get back in. And here, I'll do this for you. Please let me back. Please let me back. Please let me back. If, however, your individual need is more based on status and recognition, and a bit more narcissistic, a bit more your identity depends on being in that group, and that group threw you out, you're pissed. Your response, right after the anger, you then go in, you engage in antisocial and provocative behavior. If that club's not going to have me, I'm going to bring that group down. I'm going to get that club shut down, that sort of a thing, that attitude. Isn't that fascinating? The two paths will veer. We all share the pain, sadness, anger, and then we'll either be pro-social or antisocial, depending upon which set of needs is thwarted. And this is William's big contribution to this. It's funny, William spoke at a 2008 bullying conference. And he said, I don't know why I'm here, because I don't see ostracism tied into bullying. He said, but then I spent a day listening to everybody else's papers, and I realized I'm right in the thick of bullying. And he really is, because ostracism is one of the, this exclusion, this icing out, is one of the most common tactics of bullies, and whether it's a boss or a coworker. And it's incredibly, incredibly painful. Anyway, I think he's done a great deal to help us understand ostracism. Please go look it up. In 2011, we did an instant poll where we asked, where does your support come from for bully targets? And it confirmed what we hear anecdotally through our coaching stories and the telephone calls of people calling for help over the years. Spouses and partners hang in there. 32, most of it comes from spouses and partners. Interesting now, check this out. There are two target categories in this mix. I rely upon support from myself, 18%. Go down to 12%. No one gives me support. So that's interesting. And those are two different categories in the same question. I don't know what I was thinking when I put those in, but I'm sure it makes sense to me now. Much more so looking at the results. No one gives me support means I'm totally alone. But when I rely upon myself for support, the 18%, that's saying basically I have a personal responsibility. I will take care of myself. I need to take care of myself, as opposed to the pity me, no one is taking care of me, no one is providing support, the 12%. Coworkers, half of what families provide. Immediate family, it's all part of spouse and partner, but that can include children, of course. Therapists, 8% help. Spiritual leaders down there, just pretty much off the chart. But you'll see that the social support comes from outside of work. And that's the key. Somebody's got to be there when you're iced out and you've you've lost your sense of soul to remind you of who you were before you were targeted, and you're not a worthless piece of junk like the bully wants you to believe. Look, they've crawled inside your head trying to convince you that your identity is different than the one you have crafted for yourself over a lifetime. And that's pure bunk. They have no right to be in your head, they don't know who you are, and they have no right to redefine your identity. Identity threat, however, is one of the biggest, strongest causes of the psychological harm that bullying inflicts. So what are we going to do about it now here in our last couple minutes together? Again, there's so much more we could go on about. I just wanted to introduce the topic to you and give you some of the theoretical foundation for why people do exclude us and how we get into that bind. So here are some of the things I suggest that a bully target can do. Number one, you're going to have to ask for help, right? But as they tell rape victims, don't yell rape, yell fire. Make it relatively safe and unambiguous to help. So what I'm saying here is make the call unambiguously clear. If you come out from that meeting I was talking about before, all beat up, and you say nothing, and you maybe share a very quick glance with your coworkers, and they immediately dart their eyes to the floor, and you let them get away with it, and you stay silent, you have left that situation ambiguous. You have left it unclear whether you needed help or not. You need to come out of the office pointing accusatory fingers and screaming and yelling, not screaming and yelling, but clearly saying, you know what that fool just did? You know what that idiot just said about me? Do you know what he's saying about all of you? Do you know he doesn't respect us for anything? Do you know this? Do you know that? Do you know that? Be clear. I need your help. Will you stand with me? Are we going to take this crap? If I go down, you all go down. Blah, blah, blah. Make it unambiguous. Go back to the Kitty Genovese life and death situation. If it could be left relatively ambiguous, and the ambiguity came from the fact that those 38 witnesses were not sure what the other people were doing. Ambiguity is going to be the death of intervention. It is the key to non-intervention. It's excuse to do nothing. It's the power behind social exclusion. So erase the ambiguity, be very, very clear, and ask for help without a doubt. Step two, you have to do that immediately. You can't delay. You can't come back the next day and say, remember when I came out of the office? It has no impact. You have to say it at that point so people connect the dots. They have to see cause and effect. They don't want you to have slept on it overnight and come back, because then they'll think about motives and what's in it for them and what's in it for you, and they will have thought about what they were afraid of, and they will have rationalized their inattention and their inaction, okay? And once they're in the role of non-intervener, it has its own inertia. Inaction has its own inertia, and then you're not going to get them to spring into action. So you need the immediacy and the clarity to get people to know you need help. You have to say, help me, but you can do it in the following way. You need to know, I'm telling you, as targets, that you weren't the first, you're not the last, you're not the only. You know you're not alone. Well, with the coworker group, they also have probably had a very similar experience with the idiot and the asshole in that office. So discuss your shared experiences, for crying out loud. You need to have a discussion during break times about, has this happened to you? This is what happened to me. It just happened. Has this happened to you? Get them to talk. Break the silence. Bullying thrives when it is shrouded in secrecy and shame and quiet. And we can break that silence. Break that damn silence. And you will come to discover the great commonalities with your coworkers. Many of them have also been excluded. Many of them have been humiliated and denigrated. Then suddenly you're back in the club. You're not the one who is shunned. You're the leader of the discussion of all the shared misery. So you guys can start to brainstorm together what to do about this. The shared experiences break the silence. It is the key thing to do. Don't just skulk back and slink back into your office cubicle in silence and cry and go home sick and get more and more stressed as the months mount. And this constant unremitting exposure to this toxic climate is going to make you sicker and sicker. You're going to have a heart attack. So what you got to do is start getting healthier by talking about it, breaking the silence, and finding out that you enjoy much more social support than you have. You will break through the social exclusion and trigger social support. Now, what can coworkers do? If you are a coworker or a witness, don't exclude. Don't fail to intervene. Don't do all the things I've been crabbing about that you do. And unions, you also represent all the other workers. You need to jump on this bandwagon. When unions are party to social exclusion and icing out, which is very common because they are too are afraid of bullying often, they basically are accomplices rather than the agents of change and solution. So, basically I say, coworkers need to be educated about workplace bullying. Don't slip workplace bullying printouts of articles from our website under the boss's door if the boss is the bully. Slip them to your coworkers. Get the dialogue going. Have discussions at lunch break. Have a brown bag about workplace bullying. And not a whining session, but talking about it and empowering one another. Without that, without a doubt, you can then go on to designate some people to be interveners. Because some people have that personality. You know how whistleblowers have a particular personality? Well, interveners have a particular personality. And they're not going to take it. When they see crap, they're not going to take it and tolerate it. They have a low tolerance for inactivity and all that. And they could be trained to jump in. So if they saw things happen immediately, and you did a relatively quick call for help, a very quick, clear, unambiguous call for help, and it's been well established that that person has been through it too, that intervener is likely to go in and lead the charge and confront the bully with two or three of you, instead of what happens now is when the people talk about it. Will you go in? Oh, I'll go in. I'm with you. We're all with you. And then when you stand there, there's nothing but a breeze on your butt in the door threshold. What you really need is you need the backing of the group. The group could be interveners. And within that group of ones who have shared experiences will be people who willing or capable and willing to intervene, but not unless you've talked about it. So you have to break through the social exclusion with the discussion about bullying and the shared experiences. I hope I made my point. I know I'm being redundant, but it's really, really, really important. What can employers do? Employers can do everything. So because they're unlikely to do everything, I've put most of the responsibility on targets, which I hate to do. But targets need to compel coworkers to take action. But you know, I feel good about having coworkers take action, because if coworkers took action, we wouldn't need employer policies, and we wouldn't need laws in the states. But because coworkers are usually typically feckless and quite timid, we need employers to step up, because it is employers who control the work conditions. And we're going to need laws to compel the employers, the lazy employers, to do something about it. So the two things we clearly need employers to do about social exclusion is define it as one of the unacceptable behaviors in a long list of unacceptable behaviors, and then have a policy that prohibits bullying or destructive abusive conduct at work. Good luck with that. That's not the focus of this brief introduction to this social topic, but let me tell you, employers could go miles to stop social exclusion. However, when we say employers, what do we mean? Do we mean HR? No, I mean the executive team. But the executive team is almost always totally unaware of this operating. Or they're the ones who ordered the exclusion. So, and they approve of it. And their bullies are their agents and their underlings. And those bullies enjoy those executives as their executive sponsors. So it's a real problem to get it to stop. I think the right solution for us here today is to talk about, again, what the targets can do to convince the coworkers to take the action. Because it's the coworkers who are the ones who are doing the excluding, And that will stop the second there is a shared experience. Reestablish the empathic bond, restore the humanity, and it all works without a doubt. A lot of what we talked about here today gets a lot more attention, especially the neuroscience of group dynamics and the rest, at Workplace Bullying University. Our next session there is on the board, and you can go to workplacebullyinguniversity.com and sign up. If you would like a discount to Workplace Bullying University, you'll find that if you buy our $39 DVD full of advice for bully targets, there is a coupon in 2012 that is included, good for any of the remaining two 2012 on-site universities in Bellingham, Washington. And it's a significant discount. Thanks for participating. So do look for the announcements of upcoming webinars, and please sign up and participate. This is Gary Namie saying thank you, and be sure to visit the Workplace Bullying Institute website for help for targets, the Healthy Workplace Bill website for news about our national legislative campaign to enact the anti-bullying bill in every state in the U.S. and Puerto Rico, and the Work Doctor site for employers who actually give a damn about bullying. Know that it doesn't make them look good if they sustain bullying and actually want to improve their bottom line by stopping bullying. Please go to workdoctor.com. These, of course, are the pair of books. We also have videos available. Visit the websites. There's a lot to learn. Thanks again, and bye now.